I recently had the opportunity to sit down with our CEO, Wes Hershberger, and discuss what it means for you as a business owner or manager to create an IT strategy and how to align that strategy with your business expectations and goals. So as I go through this whole process and we've established my expectations for my technology, for my downtime, productivity, and security, how do I choose the best hardware to align with those expectations?
Okay, that's a great question. So let's think about this let's step back a little bit more and say, okay, let's say productivity is a big issue for me, that I really need uptime and I really need it to be, consistently always running and I can't be down for more than 2 hours at a time. So any kind of design that you have has to match those expectations. So let's take a server, for instance. A server is a system by itself, and it has subsystems involved in it. It has hard drives, it has memory, it has a motherboard, it has processors, it has RAM, it has power supplies, it has Ethernet ports or some kind of connectivity ports that go out into my network and so on. There are several different ways. So each one of those is a subsystem by itself, and each one of those subsystems can actually cause your whole system to go down. So if you have one hard drive and it fails, it will crash the whole system. If you have one power supply and it fails, it crashes the whole system. Your server is offline. So the strategy is how do I make sure that those things that have high probabilities of having failure don't cause my entire system to go down? So typically when you look at like a server, there may be a server that has RAID in it, for instance. That's an example of fault tolerance. A fault tolerance design says, I'm gonna put 3-4 of that particular item in, and I'm going to distribute across that the workload, or I'm gonna have the workload be there in such a way that if it fails, another one can pop right up in place. So let's say a RAID 5 with a hot spare. A hot spare just says if one of those drives fail, the hot spare picks back up and it takes the place of the one that's failed.
So now, hold on a second. We're talking about RAID. You're talking about hard drives, basically in a sequence. They can be configured different ways to copy, to either mirror data onto drives or stripe it across multiple drives for more speed and that kind of thing.
Exactly. Right. So now we're talking about things that are really getting more technical.
Right.
And that typically as a business owner or as an executive, I don't really care so much about. Right. You just tell me, just keep that thing running for me. But it's an example of what fault tolerance might be and why I would engineer fault tolerance inside of a unit. There are other things, other approaches, such as mirroring, or making a redundant system so that you have two of them working at the same time in tandem, so if one fails, the other one is just continuing to run at the same time. So that might be in an environment where I have two servers doing the exact same functions all at the same time, and if one of them goes offline, then the other one continues to run. It may be that I need that kind of redundancy happening all the time. In older days, and in certain situations, we still use these. We still use the notion of having spares. If I can tolerate that I'm going to be down for a period of time, let's say it's 4 hours or 8 hours, or even maybe it's less than that, and I just need to, I don't want to put any kind of fault tolerance into it, such as motherboards. But I want to have a spare, it might be that you buy a spare part and you have it there so that if that part fails, you can put the spare in. Today, we typically don't use that as much. Where we do use it would be in places like some manufacturing where a print head might go bad in part of the barcoding process. And if a print head goes back in that barcoding process and it has to stop my production, then that's a really bad thing. So I may have spare parts or spare printers right there that I can pop right back in place and replace that unit so that I can keep my operation going.
Makes
so it's the whole notion of how do you design your systems so that you have the least amount of disruption. My favorite is actually a distributed risk type of notion, and that is this. I would rather take my server, for instance, and build less fault tolerance, redundancies, and things like that into my server and have a failover appliance that might be on its beside it that allows me to bring it up and act as if it's my server in the case that I have a server that's got a problem. Again, what I'm doing is I'm putting less money into my server, and I'm distributing my risk across, because I have too many components that can fail into one element, one system. It allows me to have a secondary system that I can fail over to. That usually, when I talk about risk and engineering in such a way that I minimize my downtime, I like a distributed risk type of situation. That's the biggest thing. I'll give you another example of distributed risk, and that is cloud. Some cloud software allows you to think of the notion of distributed risk. For instance, Exchange. For all of us that have always had Exchange servers on our network, by going into a hosted Exchange environment, what it allows me to do is it allows me to take that piece of software, put it out on a cloud, put it out in, by being in the cloud, that means it's in a provider somewhere, in an IT data center somewhere that has all of this redundancy is built into it, and it's probably distributed between multiple data centers across somewhere in the United States and somewhere differently. It can be actually out of the United States, depending on who the provider is. But it's distributed out there. And by, again, distributed risk, you think, okay, you still have the internet you're relying on. And the answer is true, but you have access multiple ways. Maybe it's your phone, maybe it's your computer, maybe it's some other way of getting internet. So you have
multiple internet connections.
Exactly. Basically. And multiple routes out into it. So you're distributing that risk across more options to get in. You can design distributed risk, you can design fault tolerance, you can design all of these things. All of those have to match and should match with the IT strategy, with the expectations of executives, with and it should match the business. So again, if business gets disrupted and I lose a lot of money because of the disruption, then you really need to increase that type of engineering in it so that you again have a strategy of uptime. That's part of the uptime strategy.